to have all the help they need, and to find themselves and believe themselves by God. But he's hard to see sometimes. So what God has decided is to stand up, to pick agents to act for him. God doesn't have hands and feet, but his agent does. Good hands, good feet, good attitude. You are God's instruments. You are his agent. If I need a copy of the bulletin from the back, it's not, I can't go get it, but I could get you to go get it as my agent. You don't have to at the moment. But that's what an agent is. Someone who acts for the other. And what I want you to add to your thinking is, this week, I want you to practice it. Every day, if you will, if you can, start early in the morning. I want you to stop and think what it means for you to be God's agent. Now, it doesn't have to be a secret agent in that you can't tell other people, but it doesn't have to be loud and pushy either. It's just that when you go to class, you are the one who needs to look around the room and see who feels lonely. When the teams are chosen up, you are the one who notices if there's someone who hasn't been chosen, and you go over and stand with them. If you see somebody who needs help on the street, in the store, that's you. That's your job. You are God's agent to give hands and feet and help to those people. That's your job. Now, you've got other jobs in life, but you are a very special agent in that there's nobody else doing your job. What's your name? Your name? John. Very quiet. Okay. Now, you can keep it a secret if you want to and be a secret agent. Or you can just be a very special agent. But wherever you go to do God's work, there's nobody else going to do it. Yes, hey. Here you go. It's not an easy job. Some of you will forget it. They'll forget it before the day is out. And you, when you leave God's special case, there are people out there that won't get the help they need unless they work for you. You're it. You have got to be the one. Can you do it? Don't think about it. Think about it. Could be you. We've got a couple of secret agents, sure enough. He's not sure going to be a secret agent. You are a new resident. Okay. And you, madam? No, I'm sorry. I don't know what to do with that page. You're a secret agent. And the world needs you. And you? Yes. Yes. As you. Okay. Have I missed anybody? Your secret agent. Up, up, up. All right. Yes, yeah, secret agents come in all ages, sizes, shapes, possibilities.
And what I would like to, I'm going to ask you to do one more thing, then I'll let you go. On five different days before the month is out, I want you to say early in the morning, I want you to keep your degree close by your bed, on the bedside table or on the dresser, somewhere there where you can see it and think of it in the morning. And on the day when you think of it, I want you to write the date on it. Tomorrow will be May the 19th. And I want you to write that on there, you bet. Now, you might forget on Tuesday, so okay, don't put two, but on Wednesday, which is May the 21st, and you think, oh, This is a day I can be a special agent. I'm going to do that. Put that date down. And what I want you to do, if you'll get serious with me, when you've got at least 5 different dates written on there, days you thought about it and planned to be God's special agent, I want you to mail that to me. I'll leave my address at the church office because I don't live right nearby. I want you to mail that to me, and I want to write a note back to you. But we want to get the habit of knowing yourself to be God's loving special agent, the GSA degree. Thank you for your patience. Nice to know you. The grown-up to the agents too, but they're in old habits, they're harder to train. Team, I'm counting on you, and I'd love to hear from you first chance you get. Thank you very much. Go in peace.
So I have to say, it was really fun to have an article in the Journal News this week lifting up our recent discovery that George Washington's head of intelligence gathering, Colonel Benjamin Talmadge, was the grandson of our first settled pastor, the Reverend John Smith. It was timely not only because of our 300th anniversary, but also because the story of agents and double agents and triple agents, of espionage and code breaking during the War of Independence, as many of us tune in on Sunday night to watch AMC's television drama Turn. In fact, last week's episode took place almost entirely here in White Plains. My son, August, loves to play spy with his friends. Thank you, Fred, for that children's message. Secret agent, spy, it's right where he's at. There is something intriguing about secrecy and knowing something that someone else doesn't know. But while it's fun for a 7-year-old to play, we adults have become increasingly familiar with the dangers of spying in our modern world. Particularly when our own government, arguably the most powerful in the world, is spying not only on foreign nations, but on its own people, gathering huge amounts of data under what are dubious legal authorizations. As if that weren't enough, did you read this past week in the New York Times that a large section of the mighty West Antarctic ice sheet is falling apart, and its continued melting now seems unstoppable? While we don't know all that that implies, we do know that it means sea levels are going to rise to unprecedented levels. Research back in 2002 has found that a rise of even 4 feet would inundate land on which more than 3.7 million Americans live. Miami, New Orleans, New York, Boston are all highly vulnerable. Couple that with the terrifying report released last month by the United Nations that noted that heat waves and heavy rains are intensifying. Coral reefs are dying, and fish and many other creatures are migrating toward the poles or going extinct. This is the apocalyptic context in which our lives in the next 30 and 300 years will be lived. While it's possible that the impact of global warming could be moderated by factors like economic and technological change, the disruptions are nevertheless going to be profound. So given those reflections, I thought perhaps I should switch the scripture reading this morning to Revelation 6.
Thank you, Pastor. I often say I'm very comfortable with public speaking. The only time I'm nervous is in church, so here I go. And many of you know my family's connected to this church and membership here over the years, and I'm sure looking forward to what everyone wants to say is how happy I am to see all of you and to be here with you today, and to see so many of my friends, and to see John Timmons come out in his choir robes. It's fantastic, and just wonderful to be here, and Henry and everybody else. And I'm breaking the rules once we start. I have to name everyone, so I'm not going to do that. I imagine 300 years ago, I was on buildings and grounds here, so I imagine 300 years ago, they were already talking about a new boiler and a new roof, because that seems to be common to churches throughout history, but whether they were talking about a roof or a fireplace, what they were really focused on was serving others and serving God, and I think that has continued for 300 years. Advantage of that, and to serve. So the good decision then will bear fruit now. So although we're here to celebrate the 300th anniversary, I'm here to celebrate what's to come under the leadership of Pastor Jerry and this wonderful congregation and this beautiful location and this wonderful city. So, I, Thomas Adamovich, hereby, of the City of White Plains, hereby proclaim Sunday, May 18, 2014, as White Plains Presbyterian Church Day in the City of White Plains. Congratulations to all of you.